Good to see you guys this morning. Happy New Year. Hope you've survived the holidays. And here we go. If you haven't, either way, here we go. It's on. So good to have you guys here with us today. How many of you like games? How many gaming people do we have? Look at all these gaming people. You know, like, my wife loves games, and I think she's passed this on to our kids. Her whole family are into games. In fact, one of the most legendary events in her entire family history, you know, people are like, I'm related to such and such president, or I'm related to such and such general. Well, Lori's related to her great aunt Betty Sue, who made it on The Price is Right. Come on, y'all. I mean, she got tickets, she was on the second row, she got called up as the third contestant. Betty Sue guessed the price of a riding lawnmower and won it. Just what every girl wants. She played the flip-flop game and won a vacation to Malaysia. She went all the way to the showcase showdown. I don't care if you're related to the president, Betty Sue went to the showcase showdown. She lost. But it was a great run. And in her family, this is the stuff of legend. We have, it comes up a lot at the holidays. I mean, Betty Sue, you know, she was on The Price is Right. Yeah, we know. We got it. She's on The Price is Right. She loves games. If you love games, then maybe you'll remember this game. Maybe some of you even played this game over the holidays with family or friends. Remember this game? The Game of Life. We got a few Game of Life fans out there. This game, you know, like what you do is you sort of navigate around the board and you navigate through the events of life, marriage, kids, setbacks, difficulties. And the whole point of the Game of Life is to get kind of all your life tiles that you can get pulled together so that you can cash them out at the end and be able to retire in millionaire estates. And basically the winner of the Game of Life is the one who gets the most money and retires in millionaire estates. And as silly as that may sound, I think that's actually how a lot of our culture views the game, the real game of life. Like life is really just about accumulating and getting more and then getting to the end and being able to retire in millionaire estates. But I want to suggest to you today that there is a lot more to what it means to win at the real game of life. And it doesn't mean having things is bad. I hope you do well. I hope you can retire in millionaire estates. But listen, I hope you can retire in millionaire estates with a family that loves you, with people around your deathbed that are mourning your loss, with people in your life that you've impacted and influenced for God and for good. I hope you can get to that place in your life and look back and not have a mile of regrets, but instead have gratitude for all that God has seen you through. And I want to suggest that it is possible for us to get to our physical end of the game of life and have that kind of perspective. I believe it's possible to be successful, to be godly, to have your family around you that love you, to have people in your life that care, to have gratitude rather than grief over all the mistakes. And we're all going to make mistakes, but I believe it's possible to get to the end of the game of life and really win it, not just according to the board game, but according to the actual game of life. And what you will need if you're going to get to the end of real life with that kind of perspective, what you're going to need more than anything else is wisdom. You're going to need wisdom. Because wisdom is the God-given ability to determine the right thing from the unwise thing, to make decisions that you're going to face every day, every week in your life that will honor God and honor others and ultimately lead to you exhibiting the fruit of God's Spirit in your life. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That's wisdom. And more than anything else, what you and I need going into this new year is wisdom. I know some of you think, man, I just need more money. But listen, if you don't have wisdom, here's what'll happen. That money will flow right through your hands just like it did last time, right? I just need to meet a girl. I just need to meet a guy. Yeah, but if you don't have wisdom, you're not going to know when to lean into the right guy or into the right girl. Hello. Look, no, I just need the Raiders to win and go to the playoffs. But listen, if there's not some wisdom involved here, they're just going to blow out the first game of the playoffs anyway. I'm just saying. A lot of times we look around and we want to reduce what we need to just a thing. But if you have wisdom, then you have the tools and the ability to navigate all the things that will come at you. Financial challenges, parenting challenges, kid challenges, work challenges, life challenges, health challenges. If you and I have wisdom, then we can navigate through those things and ultimately be successful from a godly standpoint. Check this out. Proverbs chapter 3, beginning in verse 5. We're going to bring this up on the screens. Help me out when we get to the red word. Say it real loud here with me. This could be a verse for some of you for 2022. This could be a verse that you hang on to, you put on your fridge or on the car visor. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not what? Don't depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. Trust in the Lord with all your... Don't depend. Now, that word depend, it can be translated lean. Don't lean on your own understanding. The word was used like a chair. You know, like if you're going to sit in a chair, you're going to lean down. You're going to sit on that chair. You're going to trust that chair to carry your weight. And what the Bible's saying is, listen, you can trust God. Don't lean on your own. Don't sit on your own understanding. Some of you are, what are you doing? I'm sitting. Are you sitting on your understanding, or are you sitting on God's wisdom in your life? Don't just lean on your own understanding, right? Lean on him, and he will show you which path to take. So I want to talk to you over the next few weeks from a biblical book that is the book of wisdom. It's a book called Proverbs. Proverbs is filled with these little pithy statements that give us wisdom and insight. Proverbs is sort of like, can you imagine if you had a mentor that had lived through their life and just observed, like sat on the porch, if you will, and watched people and realized, like, well, if you do this, this will happen. And if you do this, this will happen. If you loan money to a friend, this will happen. If you cheat on another man's wife, it's like pouring burning sulfur in your lap. This will happen, right? And that's kind of what Proverbs is. It's wisdom from a tried and true perspective, somebody looking out over lots of years going, these are the things that actually work. And if you do these things, you can save yourselves a lot of heartache and pain. Now, the book of Proverbs was written by a guy named Solomon. He was the king in Israel. Solomon was known as the wisest man in the world. God had given him a supernatural gift of wisdom, and he shared that wisdom in Proverbs, and so it's there, it's available to us. Now, Solomon himself, even though he wrote these words, later in his life, he stopped living these words, and so his life became a mess. And that's the thing. You can know all the Proverbs, right? You can know all the things. You can have a PhD. You can be brilliant. You can read a book every week. You can have degree after degree after degree, and you can still be a fool. You can be somebody with no formal education, but you choose to listen to God's word and live it in your life. And from a biblical standpoint, you can become wise. And that wise choices and actions can lead to success. So next week, I want to talk to you about advancing at work from what the book of Proverbs says. The week after that, I want to talk to you about advancing in relationships from what Proverbs tells us. But today, I want to talk to you about wisdom, because if we have wisdom, then we can manage all the other things that are coming at us. God's wisdom can help you win at life. So my first thought going into a new year is this: seek God's wisdom. Just seek it in your life. Somebody put this up on a slide on social media. There's some wisdom in this statement. This person said, I tried to text, I'm on my way, but sent, I'm in my way, and I think I just had a therapy breakthrough. How many of you know what it's like to be in your own way? I feel like I've spent most of my life in my own way, right? I can't get out of my own way for the life of me, you know? And this is, I think, what we tend to do. Well, Proverbs wants to help you and me get out of our own way. Proverbs wants to save us from some pain and some heartache. Check this out. Proverbs chapter 14, beginning in verse 12. It says, help me on the red word when we get there. It says, there is a path before each person that seems what? Right. Seems right. But it ends in death. Proverbs says, look, on your own, there's a path that may seem like the right thing. That's good. That's right. But if you just simply do what's right in your own eyes, eventually it often leads to pain and heartache and spiritual death. And the Bible's saying we need more. In fact, the Greek word for our English word idiot is the word idios. Okay? Idios. You know what idios actually means, literally? It means one's own. An idios is somebody who does things on one's own, according to one's own, according to one's own understanding. So an idiot is literally somebody who's shut off from all the insight and knowledge of others, and they're like, I'm just going to make my own decision. I'm going to go my own way. I'm going to do my own thing. Proverbs will come along and help us. Wisdom in the book of Proverbs is described as a parent begging a child to make choices so that it doesn't cause them pain in the long run. Every parent can understand this, right? You have a kid, he keeps sticking his finger in the electrical socket, and you're like, dude, I am trying to help you, right? They keep grabbing all kinds of junk, sticking it in their mouth. You're like, no, 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 I'm trying to help you. That's what Proverbs is. It's God's word coming along like a parent saying, I'm trying to stop you from experiencing a lot of pain. Now, we all know we're people. Sometimes the only way we learn, if you're like me, you got to go out and get hit over the head with a 2x4. And then you're like, oh, okay, that's what they were talking about. I get it. But to the degree that we will lean in and listen, we can save ourselves from some of that pain. Proverbs is also described as a woman. Or wisdom is also described in Proverbs as a woman standing in a courtyard, and she's calling out for anybody who will listen. And the Bible says everybody's walking past her. Nobody pays attention because they're all busy and they're all distracted. And when I think of 2022, everybody's walking by looking on their phone. We got so many things going on, so many things coming at us. Wisdom is calling out if we will stop. And we will listen. And so this year is a choice, and it's a chance for us to seek God's wisdom. His word actually has things to say about how you manage money, how you navigate conflict, how you deal with things at work, how you answer somebody who accuses you, how you handle somebody who wrongs you, how you conduct yourself in your affairs. And Proverbs will help you move forward in your life in a healthy way. Now, let me just sort of frame up real quick. I'll get academic with you. But let me just kind of frame up the book of Proverbs. The Bible has this whole section of the Old Testament called wisdom literature. It's typically thought of as five books: Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Job, and then Psalms and Song of Solomon, which don't really have a lot of like core wisdom sayings in them, but they're often like put in that category. But of those five, these three books are like the core like wisdom books of the Old Testament: Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Job. Proverbs is sort of like a teacher, like we've said. It's like positive and constructive, and this teacher's gonna give us insight and comments for how to live. Ecclesiastes is sort of like the critic or the cynic. Ecclesiastes is more negative and deconstructive. It's more like this guy comes along, he calls himself the teacher. Teacher, by the way, in Ecclesiastes. And some people have said, you know, it's Solomon who wrote Ecclesiastes towards the end of his life after he had made a mess of things. And Solomon or whoever wrote it is kind of looking around going, hey, like, you know, there's some really bad things that have happened to really good people. And there's some really good things that have happened to some really bad people. And it doesn't always work out like this, right? And then you have Job, And Job is like the survivor. It's more balanced and reconstructive. Job's this guy, Satan comes along, asks to tempt Job, and God allows it to happen. And Job, even though he lived by the Proverbs, he lived righteously, Job finds himself in a situation where he loses everything, even though he lived well. And eventually his friends all come and sit around and debate, like why is this happening? And his friends are actually debating a lot of the principles of Proverbs. And his friends are going like, man, what do you think Job did? Who do you think Job cheated on? Or who do you think he wronged? What do you think Job lied about? Because, you know, Job wouldn't be going through all this if he had lived a righteous life. And what's interesting about Job is as it goes along, eventually God comes to Job's friends and basically rebukes them and tells them to kind of be quiet and sit down. You don't know what you're talking about. And God eventually restores to Job all that he lost. Job is the survivor, but Job just reminds us that life is filled with mystery. And God is mysterious. Sometimes God doesn't fit in a 30-minute sermon. Hello. And certainly sometimes God doesn't fit our little categories. So these are the wisdom books of the Old Testament. I say all of this to say, Proverbs are not promises. Okay, this is not, when you read a proverb, that's not a promise from God. It's a principle from God. A principle says it's true most of the time, right? Sometimes it may not be, but most of the time, if you live this way, it will prove out true. This is a pathway to save you from heartache and hurt. It doesn't mean 100% of the time, every single time, it will always work out this way. Proverbs is more about being positive and constructive, and where these other books balance the message of Proverbs, Proverbs is saying, listen, lean into wisdom and listen. So let's check out a few Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 22, beginning in verse 6. It says, direct your children onto the right path, and when they are older, they will not leave it. This is a proverb. It's not a promise. We've all known parents who've tried to raise their kids well and do all the right things, and their kids went way off the path and never came back, right? We see that. That's happened. And look, it doesn't mean they were something was wrong with them. You know, like, I've known some parents that were amazing parents that had little hellions as kids. And I've known some parents that were horrible. And for some reason, in the mysterious universe, they had little angels for babies, right? It doesn't always line up, and I know that. But here's what Proverbs is saying. If you're a young parent here, or you're a parent with kids, your best chance to see those kids grow up and stay on the path is right now to be intentional about raising them on the path. More often than not, if you raise them on the path, they will, when they're older, not depart from it. When I think about Lori and I raising our kids, the most important thing that we ever did was we got our kids in church, and we raised them in church. And it didn't fix everything, but when there was a camp, we sent them to camp. When there was an opportunity to be involved in an event for their age at church, we got them involved. We wanted to expose them not only to God, but we wanted to expose them to friends that shared their faith. And that community, I think, is really everything. And so, as an encouragement to some of you parents, you raise your kids on the path. The rest is in the Lord's hands, right? It doesn't mean they won't go through the alien years. It doesn't mean they won't go through the crazy years, maybe the rebellious years. But it means eventually the hope and prayer is that they come back and they land on their feet and they walk on the path. Some of you are in that phase right now where your kids are off in la la land, and it's worrying you and tearing you up, and you're praying for them, and you're stressed. Some of you are that kid, and you need to call your mama and tell her you love her. And you went to church today. That'll do her well. But listen, I want to encourage you, because in the midst of that stress and fear, sometimes you got to hold on to this verse. It's not a promise, but it is a principle. And you can hold on to it, that you raised your kids on the path. We all raise our kids imperfectly. Maybe you raised them very imperfectly. I certainly have. But I raised my kids on the path, and when they are old, I believe that they will come back to it. God, I'm hanging on to that principle in my life. All right. Here's another proverb. Look at this. Pride goes before destruction, and haughtiness before a fall. And it's not the pride that we might have in our hearts towards other people that's like proud of an accomplishment or, you know, I'm proud of this. But it's like when you start thinking you're better than everybody else, here's the thing. When you start thinking that you know it all and you won't listen to anybody anymore. Any of you know a know-it-all? Don't raise your hand if you're sitting right beside him. Bible's saying pride goes before destruction. It's inevitable when you see that. Just Proverbs says, this is what thousands of years of wisdom has taught us. Sit back and watch the show because the fall will come. That's why I get worried when my Dallas Cowboys, you know, go like 50 points against the Eagles, our rival. But I love the Eagles. It's love-hate, you know, like they're family, right? Because this rivalry has gone on for so long. But you know, like I'm watching this play out, and I get a little concerned because if I know the Cowboys, they're going to think they're all that. And then next week, they're going to be like, yeah, we're awesome. Did you see what we... And then they're going to fall right on their face because that's what they do. Anyway. I'm like, stay humble, boys. Stay humble. You know? Here's another one. Proverbs chapter 15. Moving on. The gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Look, you get in a confrontation this week. Somebody comes up to you at work. Somebody comes up to you at home, and they're ramping it up, right? Their language is aggressive. Those of you that work with customers, you face this, you know, if not daily, weekly. Their language is aggressive. They're fired up. Man, there's only one way to turn the wrath down, and that is a gentle answer. A gentle answer. So often what we do is we ratchet it up. Or we don't even do it necessarily with our words, but we do it on social media. We do it with our thumbs, right? You don't have to type in all caps for people to get the message. Feel the fire coming through, right? And then it's now, you know, look, if you get down in the mud and start slinging mud, you're going to get mud all over you. Proverbs is saying, if you want to tone things down, just answer gently. And maybe they'll still be ramped up, but just keep answering gently. And eventually, it'll bring things down in your life. Proverbs 4:7 says this. Get wisdom, though it costs all you have. Get understanding. The thing we need in 2022, more than success, more than a raise, more than, you know, that house or that place to live, more than that car, more than that new thing. The thing we need in 2022 is wisdom, because wisdom is the key that can help us unlock all the doors and be able to walk through them well. Seek God's wisdom. Seek God's wisdom in your life. Here's another thought, and that's to reset your priorities. Reset your priorities. How many of you, when you play a game, play to win? Who are the people that play to win? You're like, why are we even playing if we're not playing? And I mean, you'll slit a family member's throat right at the dining room table, you know, like, it's figuratively, you know, you'll just be like, blup, you're dead. Who's next, right? You play to win. Now, how many of you just play for fun? Anybody just play? Yeah, you just play for fun. You're married to the person who plays to win. So you play for fun. You're just out to have a good... When you have different priorities, it changes how you play the game. And when it comes to the game of life, we got to have our priorities in line. Here's what Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7 tells us about priorities and what's most important. It says, respect and obey the Lord. This is the what? The beginning of knowledge. Another way of translating it is, the Bible says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. This is where it starts. That fear isn't like terror, like you're walking around terrified, but it's that awe. It's that respect. It's the realization of like, I'm really small. This is a really big universe. And God is very large and in charge. And I just acknowledge that. I walk with a sense of reverence for that in my life. And if you will reset your priorities going into the new year with that as the top priority, and then let it trickle down into your life. I'm going to give you quickly my top five personal priorities for this next year. And these aren't really that insightful, but I just wrote them down as honestly and clearly as I could. I have other goals, other things I want to accomplish. So do you. Dreams you want to go after this year. But whatever I'm doing, These are my top priorities while I'm doing it. Number one is simply God. Number one, my first priority going into the new year and really going into every year is God. And when it comes to God, you know, this is one of those priorities that you would think, well, yeah, Judd, you're a pastor. That's obvious. But when I say it, I mean this. Before I'm a pastor, before the work of the church, the thing that I want to do in my life ahead of everything else is live a surrendered life to God. And I do things, this would scare some people, but it shouldn't scare you. I can tell you after decades of doing this, God has blessed me in this. I'll take my wallet, I'll set it out before the Lord. God, all I have is yours. Whatever you want me to give, tell me, I'll give it. Who you want me to support, I'll support them. What do you want me to do? It's yours. Like, I surrender to you. God, I give you my time. I give you my family. I give you my work. You call me somewhere else, God, I'll go. You want me to give it all up and travel over here and do that? I'll do it, God, I'm yours. I'm surrendered. Jesus says, if you're willing to lose your life, you'll find it. And I've found over the years that prayer, which might seem scary, is actually not scary at all, because God can fill you with joy and meaning and purpose and bless you in your life. So I start every day with God, and that's not work for me. I'm not trying to get a message together. Every day, the first thing I do, 15 minutes to an hour or whatever I have, I start with the Bible and I start with God, and that's personal. Not Pastor Judd, just Judd before God. And you can do that as well in your own life. But for me, that's my way of saying, God, you are first before everything else. Second thing is family. Family. And I think this is important because a lot of people, work is very important. We'll talk about work. But a lot of people, they put their family sort of after work. It's like, yeah, work's kind of the thing. And then if there's time left over, we'll do the family thing. And a lot of times people will sort of go about life in such a way that they think, man, God, I'm going to work and work and work and pray you give me success. I'm going to put in insane hours and pray you bless it. And then I'm going to pray you take care of my family. And I want to suggest to you that maybe that's a deal God doesn't make. And if you flipped it the other way around, you'd be more in line with his priorities, where you say, God, look, I'm going to take care of my family. I'm going to make sure I still have relationships with those you've given me in my life. And it might mean I work a little less. Still work hard, but I might work less. And then, God, I'm going to pray that you fill the gaps at work. And you may be surprised at how God can fill the gaps at work. Family is my number two priority. By the way, speaking of family, last week I talked about, a little over a week ago at Christmas, talked about how I lost Lori's wedding gift, and I had bought her this gift, and I couldn't find it, the box, and I didn't know where it was, and I looked all over the house, and I thought I was losing my mind. Well, on Christmas Day, she opened this box, and I think I just thought the size of the box was different. Maybe I didn't even have another, I don't know what happened, but it was wrapped, and I got it wrapped. And it was sitting under the tree. And she opened it. We've got a little picture here we're going to bring up. There it is. Now, in case you're wondering, like, what kind of gift is that? My wife likes these really niche-y, artsy gifts, like on Etsy. So, this particular thing is a watercolor painting by some guy in the Navy in the 1950s or 40s. I don't know. And I mean, it's not expensive. I think the whole thing, shipping and all, was like $70, right? But he painted the Sunset Cliffs in California, which is where my daughter goes in college when she's stressed out. And so Lori decides she wants this little painting of the Sunset Cliffs by some dude nobody's ever heard of in the Navy. And she's going to put it behind her. And it's going to be... So I'm telling you all this to say, the reason I was so stressed out about it is not because it was expensive. It's because there's only one. And if you lose it, it's gone. Anyway, I didn't lose it. I may be losing my mind, but I didn't lose the gift. Here's the third priority, and that is church. And I think church is just hugely important for all of us. If you want to set yourself up for success, not only next year, but in future years, you got to prioritize the church. It's interesting. Some people criticize the capital C church or get frustrated with the church, and I get that. But never forget this. Jesus called the church or the Bible calls the church the bride of Christ. It is his bride. When you attack a church, even if there may be issues, just remember in general, man, you're attacking something Jesus loves, right? Because the church is filled with broken, messed up people. Guess what? You and I are exhibit A, right? Thank God. We love to thank God when it's us. We get frustrated when it's other people. God loves the church. And if you want to align yourself in his wisdom this next year, make a commitment to be in church. And I don't mean once a quarter. I mean, every week you can be there or watch online. Make a commitment to say, God, I'm going to lean in and listen and learn and build relationships and grow. All right, here's another area, and that's health. Health is really important. I don't really know where to put health. It's one of my priorities, which is if you don't take care of your health, you really don't have the ability to do anything else. And I think we all know that. And so I don't want to put health number one, and I don't want to put health above my family, and I can't bring myself to put health above the church. Just saying. So I put health here, but you can put health wherever you want. I just know it's important, and we've got to prioritize it. And then the fifth one is work. And work is, some of you are like, why you put work at the end? Look, it's not at the end, it's on the list, right? There are only five things that I prioritize, and this is one of them. Work's important. A lot of people think God kind of doesn't care about work some people say, well, you look back at the book of Genesis, God cursed work. No, God doesn't curse work. God cursed the ground, but he doesn't curse work. Work itself is a gift from God. God is a God who works. I mean, I think sometimes we get this idea in our lives that, like, if we could just, quote unquote, retire and just sit around and not do anything, that would be amazing. Now, I had a friend that his brother did this and retired early and moved off to a remote island and basically lived the beach island lifestyle and had internet access and just sat around. And after about 3 or 4 years, I was talking to my friend. He goes, yeah, my brother's moving back to the States. I said, really? He goes, yeah, he's going back to work. I said, man, he had it all. Like he was like 40 and had everything and like retired. He goes, this is exactly what he told me. He goes, I got to the bottom of Netflix. He's like, man, I watched everything there was to watch. I streamed everything there was to stream. I got to the end and realized I got to do more with my life. I mean, I wouldn't mind finding out what that's about for a few years. Anybody feel me here? But like work in and of itself in general is a gift from God. And especially if you can do work that eventually you find meaningful and aligns with your purpose, it's a gift. I think it only sounds fun to sit around and do nothing until you actually sit around and do nothing for a while. And then we all start going a little stir crazy, right? So work can be a gift. We're going to talk about that next week. So those are some priorities. But here's the point. If you want to get to the end of your life or the end of this year and be on the road to success at the real game of life, lean into God's wisdom. You know, I think about the person that did this for me and lived it out powerfully in my life was my father. And he's passed away now, but my father, he came from nothing. I mean, he could remember growing food out behind their house in the alley during the Great Depression, you know, just to be able to eat. He remembered at Christmas they would make little toys out of wood that they got out, you know, just scrapping around on the streets. They'd make little things and give that to one another. But there was no money for Christmas gifts. You know, there was nothing. And then my dad in high school, he dropped out of high school, lied about his age, and went to serve in World War II like many did in that generation, and served in the Battle of the Bulge and saw all kinds of crazy stuff and rose up to the level of master sergeant in the army. He comes back home to America. He falls in love with my mom. My dad always put it this way. He said, son, we're from this side of the tracks. And your mom was from the other side of the tracks, if you know what I'm saying. And he said her dad wasn't very happy that she fell in love with a little scrapper who didn't have anything. On their first wedding anniversary, my dad gave my mom a Hershey candy bar because he only had 5 cents to his name. And he said, for every year we're married, I'll add one to it. In the latter years of their lives, he was buying 50, 60 Hershey bars. He started buying the little Hershey bars because he's like, we can't add on any more weight. There's always Hershey bars in my house. But here's the thing. My dad started his own business. led it from nothing over 30 years. At different points, he almost went bankrupt. At one point, he leveraged everything he owned just to keep the doors open, just to keep it going. He'd seen ups and downs. Towards the end of his life, he had had some success. He'd been very generous, been faithful. And my dad was not perfect, but he literally lived his life based on the principles of the Proverbs. He didn't have education. He didn't have money. He didn't have resources. But you know what he had? He had the Bible, and he believed it. He had God, and he depended on him. And he built his life on the wisdom principles of the Proverbs. You honor your word. Your yes is your yes. You don't mess with another man's wife. Hello. You treat people with respect. You just go down the list, right? Those were the kinds of things that my dad lived. Not perfectly, but he lived them. And here's what I saw at the end of his life, all of his kids around his deathbed, weeping and grateful, loving him and thankful. I saw my dad at the end of his life, not afraid to die. I remember he was in a lot of pain and he was laying there and he was kind of unconscious, in and out, and they kept zapping him with this defibrillator, and when it would go off, like that it was implanted in him, he thought it was like restarting his heart and keeping him alive, and it wasn't. But that's what he thought, because it really hurt. And at one point, he'd been like totally kind of delirious and out of it for days. And all of a sudden, he gets zapped by his defibrillator, and he sits up, and he's just angry, because it hurts. And he looks right at me, and why he looked at me, I don't know. He looks right at me, and he goes, "You better get that heart doctor in here right now. I paid him a lot of money, and I should be dead by now." And then he lays back down. He's out. That's how a master sergeant in the Army gets ready to die. And I'm like, yes, sir, yes, sir. A few days before he passed away, kind of his last conscious moments, I was gathered in his room with family and knelt beside his bed, and we knew this was the end. And my dad, he hadn't been responsive at all. And I began to just tell him like how much I loved him and how thankful I was for him. And was grateful for, man, my addiction years and how he prayed me through that and the mess that I made of so much of my life in those early years and how he was faithful and never gave up on me. And all of a sudden, my dad had this lucid moment. And he looked over at me and he smiled. And he said, "You're good kids. I'm going for a walk in the sunshine. I'll see you on the other side." And that was it. He smiled, turned his head, and a few days later, he went home to be with God. But ever since that moment, years ago, I think I've been different. I think I've just looked at life differently. It doesn't really matter how many degrees you have or how much accomplishment you have, or whether you can retire in millionaire estates. If you're going to get to the end of your life and not have any loved ones around you and have a whole list of regrets, then that's a fail. But if you can get to the end of your life with your friends and family that you love, who love you, if you can get to the end of your life without a mile long worth of regrets, if you can get there having lived with character and integrity, imperfectly, but if you can get there and even be ready to face God, not because of your righteousness, but because of Jesus, then that's a wise life. That's the kind of life I want for myself. It's the kind of life I want for you. And the way we get there is now, starting today and backing up and saying, what should our priorities be? What's going to matter now and what's going to matter then, right? How should we frame up life? What is the wise thing to do? Maybe this week, that's the question we should start laying over every decision, every significant decision. What is the wise thing to do? Is it wise to go cuss out my boss? Is it wise to ratchet things up with my spouse? Is it wise to have a loving intervention conversation? Maybe it is. But that's the kind of question that reframes your thinking. And then you and I have a resource in the book of Proverbs. We'll look at it over the next few weeks. You can take one a day. You can take one a week. If you're an overachiever, you can read a chapter a day and finish the whole book in 31 days, right? And you could do that 12 times in a year if you're a super overachiever. Somebody in the room right now is like, yeah, I'm doing that. I'm doing that while I work out. You go, man. But we build our lives on wisdom, and God will move and work through that. And we can win at the game of life God's way when we build it on His wisdom. Maybe you're here today, and maybe you've never crossed that line of faith, and I'd love to give you that opportunity. Just reach out to God and allow Him to move and work in your heart and in your life. So I'm going to ask all of you, would you bow your heads and close your eyes? And if you'd like to become a follower of Jesus today, just repeat this simple prayer after me to take that step to open your heart to Him. Just say, dear God, I thank You for loving me. Thank You for sending Jesus into the world. I believe He died on the cross for my sins. I believe He rose again. Forgive me for my sins. Give me the gift of eternal life. Help me face the challenges that I'm up against. God, I surrender my life to You. In Christ's name. And friends, with every head bowed and every eye closed, if that's your prayer today, if it's your commitment, I want to ask you to just slip your hand in the air. Just make eye contact with me, just to say before God, to say to me, you're going to trust Him. You're going to follow Him in your life. God bless you guys. Thank you. Just slip your hand in the air. Thank you. Thank you. Reach out to Him today. Thank you. God, we love You. I thank You for each person just reaching out to You. Fill their lives. Fill us with Your joy, Your goodness, Your peace. May they know You and grow in You. May they find forgiveness and favor. May we all walk in Your favor in 2022. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's put our hands together for those who made spiritual commitments in their life. If you made a spiritual commitment, I want to say congratulations. I want to encourage you to go to central.family and just click the link. I've decided to follow Jesus. We'd love to follow up with you and connect with you and send you a free gift as we move into the new year. Well, I'm going to ask all of you, would you stand together with me? And as you stand, let's put our hands together for Pastor Nick, who's going to come share a few final thoughts with us.